He says to us, as he says to Paul, come to me just as you are.
Too often we have looked at the rough and judged it for not being smooth, or looked at the valley and thought it could not be raised. We have observed the mountain, believing it would be unscalable, and in so doing we would become complacent. Forgive us, God, for our complacency and our judgments. Make us see with the eyes of the Lord, knowing that you have called us on this way, will make the path before us. Lord, when we are too distracted to hear your voice, Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
When your call seems too difficult and we turn away, Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
When we cannot face the challenge, the pain, or the healing, Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us. Forgive us our sins and bring us everlasting. Father, Holy Second Sunday, Almighty God, purify our hearts and minds, that when your Son Jesus Christ comes again, as judge and Savior, we may be ready to receive him, who is our Lord and our God.
Amen.
Reading from the second letter of St. Peter. Do not ignore this one fact, beloved, that with the Lord one day is like a thousand years, and a thousand years are like one day. The Lord is not slow about his promise, as some think of slowness, but is patient with you, not wanting any to perish, but all to come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief, and then the heavens will pass away with a loud noise, and the elements will be dissolved with fire, and the earth and everything that is done on it will be disclosed. Since all these things are to be dissolved in this way, all sorts of persons, urge you to be in leading lives of holiness and godliness, waiting for and hastening the coming of the day of God, because of which the heavens will be set ablaze and dissolved, and the elements will melt with fire. But in accordance with his promise, we wait for new heavens and a new earth where righteousness is at home. Therefore, beloved, while you are waiting for these things, strive to be found by him at peace, without spot or blemish, and regard the patience of our Lord as salvation. This is the word of the Lord.
Comes at the beginning of the book. But wait a minute, I hear
new sign? No,
perhaps not.
It says here, chapter 14, verses 1 to 11. That doesn't sound like the beginning of the book. Well, if I can be a little bit nerdy for a moment, scholars are generally agreed that what we call the book of the prophet Isaiah is actually three books. The first 39 chapters were probably written by a man called Isaiah, but the rest was added by two other writers quite a bit later. Chapters 40 to 55 are what we call second Isaiah. And chapters 56 to 66 are, yes, you got it, third Isaiah. So at the beginning of chapter 40, we have a new man standing up, just like the tenor soloist in the Messiah. So what's he got to say? And what's the point? Has he got anything to say to us today in our situation? Well, he starts off in fine style with some lovely words about comforting and speaking tenderly, probably addressed to the Israelites who were in forced exile in Babylon. Okay, you've been punished enough, your troubles are coming to an end. God is coming to save you, to prepare a path through for you through the wilderness, to take you home where you belong, and all people will see God's glory. We can certainly appreciate how his listeners may have felt because, well, we've had our share of wilderness experiences over the last few months, haven't we? What would it mean to us if the uneven ground were to become level and the rough places plain? And how many times have we said, please God, do something? But at this point, our prophet seems to lose his way a little bit. A voice tells him to cry out. He doesn't quite know what to say. What shall I cry, he says. And then he gives us some stuff about people being like grass and the flowers of the field, which wither and die when the breath of the Lord blows over it. It's lovely poetry, but it's not exactly what you want to hear. We don't need reminding of our mortality. The evidence of it is all about us, and it gets more compelling day by day. But, and this is a very important but, he says, the word of our God will stand forever. Get up into a high mountain and shout it out as loud as you can. Here is your God. Despite appearances, despite what people tell you, God is in charge. He loves you, and he will not let you come to real harm. And then there follows that wonderful verse about God feeding his flock like a shepherd and gathering the lambs into his arms. The writer is not sure how things are going to work out, but he knows that somehow God will save his people. It seems that our nameless author was writing in a particular historical situation. He foresees that the Babylonian Empire will be overthrown by the Persian King Cyrus, and the Israelites about to return home. But St. Mark is writing a very different situation. Nevertheless, that doesn't stop him appropriating and adapting second Isaiah's words, linking them with some words from the prophet Malachi. In Isaiah, the voice crying in the wilderness is the prophet himself. In Mark, of course, it's John the Baptist. Have you ever thought in Mark that after telling us that he's going to write about Jesus the Christ, Mark then starts to tell us about some other person, this rather strange character, John?
used in this passage, which all point to the coming of the Messiah, the Anointed One, who would, metaphorically speaking, lead the Israelites out of the wilderness into the Promised Land, where they would live in freedom and harmony. Most of them would no doubt see that in political terms, getting rid of the hated Romans, and to adapt a recent but now rather tarnished slogan, making Israel great again. That's why they expected the Messiah to be a great warrior. But, as always, God has other ideas. We know how the story ends. Instead of imposing his will by force, Jesus shows that the only way to achieve freedom is through selfless love, forgiveness, and sacrifice. Who could have foreseen that? God is a God of surprises, we know. We never really know what he's up to. I don't think the author of 2nd Isaiah knew how things would turn out in detail. And I'm not sure that John the Baptist really knew that Jesus of Nazareth, who Luke tells us was his cousin, really was the promised Messiah. Because you remember that there's that one point where he sent his disciples to ask Jesus, "Are you really the one to come, who is to come? Or should we look for someone else?" Because Jesus was not the sort of Messiah he was expecting. But, like Tony in West Side Story, we can say, something's coming. I don't know what it is, but it's going to be great. Both 2nd Isaiah and Psalm teach us that God is in control, that God loves us absolutely, unconditionally, and that he will lead us out of our wilderness into true freedom. We live in hope, hope which is based on God's promises to us. And as St. Peter says in our New Testament reading, we wait for new heavens and a new earth where righteousness is at home. Amen. So now we affirm our faith in the words of this Celtic style proclamation of faith. Please stand. We believe in God above us, maker and sustainer of all life, of sun and moon, water and earth, of man and female. We believe in God.
throne, may you find us loyal, God in you. May you find us striving for peace and looking forward to your glory. We remember today all our wanting to be baptized. We pray for prayers, God prayers and sponsors. We come with all of our sorrow for our sins and do want to live with your life. We come with all we seek forgiveness and cleansing. Lord, change us.
Amen. So
we remember all of our striving for peace. Bless the leaders of nations and peacekeeping forces. Guide the United Nations on the work of the new days. May we strive for justice and freedom for all. Lord, change us. Lord, we ask that our homes may be places of welcome, love and harmony. May we make room for you in our lives and our world. Lord, change us.
Amen.
We come before you in all of our struggling, those who are ill, and at all our hearts. Care of our hospice, the world's poor, the oppressed, the neglected, those who feel alone, and all who suffer from violence, persecution, or rejection. My name we pray for. Kenny Baker-Darker, Dorothy Webster, Theo Hamilton, Margaret Olson, Brenda Sitchman, John Kenyon, Ivy Holton, Pat Edwards, Alan Smith, Calvin Platt, Lorraine Lee, David Murray, and Claire Bell. May all of your healing presence today and always, Lord, change us.
And we shall be changed.
We remember and pray for all who have died, our friends and loved ones, among them, Father Price, Stephen Nicholson, Robert Wallace, Doreen Jennings. We also remember all who have died in our beloved spirit, and those whose anniversary falls at this time, especially Helen Lurch, James Kennedy, Kate Ashcroft, Reg Birch, Albert Parker, Thomas Castle, Thelma Sixman, David Sixman, Mary Wilson, Thomas Palmer, Mary Margaret Lemons, George Robert Wilson. Lord, change us. We give thanks for the lives of all your saints.
fulfilment of your promise will be fulfilled. We now watch for the day when Christ our Lord will come again. And so we join our voices with angels and archangels and all the company to proclaim your glory forever, praising you. So, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him we pray with confidence his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross. Bringing before you the bread of life and the cup of salvation, we proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory. Great is the mystery of faith.
Somewhere a young person is crying, crying for a listening ear, or an understanding heart. Somewhere an old person is crying, crying for a visit or a word from a family member or neighbour. Somewhere